dread frown, and low in the pit where my sin dragged me down, I cried to the Lord from the deep. My clay you tenderly brought me out to golden clay. Oh, he brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock to stay. He put us on so upon a strong rock by his side, my steps were established, and here I'll abide. No danger of falling, why here I remain, but stand by his grace until the crown I lay. For he brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the rock to stay, and he put a song in my soul today, a song of praise. A song, 'twas a new song of praise. By day and by night, its sweet notes I will raise. My heart's overflowing, I'm happy and free. I'll praise my Redeemer who has rescued me. Oh, he brought me out of the miry clay. He set my feet on the road to stay. He put a song in my soul. Song, 'twas a new song of praise. By day and by night, its sweet notes I will raise. My heart's overflowing, I'm happy and free. I'm gonna praise my Redeemer who has rescued me. Oh, he brought me, oh, have you been brought out tonight? Oh, thank you, Jesus, on the road to stay. Oh, he put a song in my soul. Oh, for anyone who's ever seen the mountains of their sins just disappear. For anyone who's ever felt the hand of heaven reach down through their ears and dry their tears. For any life once empty and now finds itself alive and full of songs, victory songs. You'll understand the reason, the way the saints of God may carry on. So when I shout, though I'm shouting from a heart that's been washed clean, when I run, though I'm running from a path that's been breathing, to the world in life of crazy, there's just no telling what you're gonna do in that moment. Jesus gets a hold of you. So when I shout, the way the saints of God may carry on. When I shout, future. We are the hope beyond the grave. Oh, every life's a different story. How he led us out of darkness into his light. There's just no way to keep us silent. Every breath's another chance to testify. Oh, and I'll shout, no, I'll shout.
Let's see. Let's sing it again.
How great
from the innermost part of your being, sing it unto the Lord. Could you move up from your pew, shake somebody's hand, and tell them we serve a great God?
Oh, then Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation.
Clap of praise in the house. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I feel Him in the house tonight. Amen. We know where two or three are gathered in His name, He's in the midst, but I love to feel Him. Praise the Lord. If our ushers could come while they're coming, I want to give you those announcements again. Life and Purpose Group will have another softball game this Friday, August the 25th, Lindsay Park. I don't know if it's this Friday or it's on a Friday, August 25th, 7 p.m. If you want to be a participant in that, see Brother David, Sister Michelle Boykin. And then a baby shower, Saturday, August 19th, 6 p.m., honoring Brother Gus and Sister Cameron Morales. It's a boy and registered at Target and Bye Bye Baby. There will be a gift table provided for gift cards and cash bake sale. The Primetimers will be hosting a bake sale Sunday, August the 20th, following the morning service. All proceeds will go to their upcoming trip to Branson. We want to help our Primetimers. They help all of our ministries get to where they need to go. I mean, our youth, our school of ministry, everything, they're so intricately involved. We want to be a blessing to our Primetimers, our seniors. And also, Harvest Time Christian Academy will be starting up very soon. So we have a parent-teacher orientation August the 22nd at 6:30 p.m. And then school will begin on September the 6th. That's a Wednesday, right? That's a Tuesday. Okay, it's a typo. So that next Wednesday, that week, we're going to be starting back our Wednesday night meals. So that'll be starting off back very soon. Back to school youth rally, Friday, August the 25th. And then Wednesday, wedding shower honoring Travis Browning and Whitney Sin, Saturday, August the 26th at 2 p.m. So we have all these things. And also, our school of ministry will be coming in from 10 different states around the country. It's so exciting when our new group comes in. This is our fifth year to have a school of ministry. This year we have 27 students. That's just remarkable. It's amazing how the Lord has just grown the school like this. And we feel very, very honored that God would allow us to be a part of helping shape these young ministries, these young people, college-age students coming in. We're very excited about that. We know God is up to something. And I just want to be a part of what the Lord is doing in this last day harvest. Amen. Brother Brian, could you bless the offering?
He promised to hold my head. He promised to help me stand when the valley's too low and the river's too wide. He promised he would lead me to the other side. His promise is life my way and liberty my feet to stray. Living in his word, I will overcome. Standing on his promise is one by one.
I believe that living by his word, you're going to overcome. You may be seated. Thank you, musicians and singers. To those seven churches of Minor Asia, Revelation chapter 2 and 3, at the end of each message, there's a message. The closing statement is to him that overcometh. The only ones that are going to make it to heaven is he that overcometh. Amen. We don't overcome in our own strength or own might. We do it by the help and the grace of God. But we got to make up our mind what we're going to do. I believe that. I believe most of it is a determination. Get your mind made up. I'm not going to turn back. I'm going to put my hand to the plow, and I'm not going to look back. I'm going to ask you this week that you would be in prayer for us as we travel. Be faithful to the Wednesday night service. This church is so faithful. I'm telling you, this is a special group of people. We were going to be gone Monday through Saturday, and I'm going to be traveling with my good friend, Brother Jeremy Prochazka here. He's a flaming national evangelist here. Now he's going to move on over to El Salvador. And Brother George Trevino is going to be going with us. And Brother Jackson Slider, Brother Jose Bernal, Brother Andrew Navarez, Brother Caleb Gregory, and then Brother Victor is going to be flying from Tegucigalpa, Honduras, into San Salvador. He's going to meet us there. We've just now had a group, Sister Wendy Montoya. She just brought 12 across the border of Nicaragua, so they're in the city of San Salvador. We're going to be heading to El Congo to meet us. Then Brother Luis Vargas is bringing 6 or 7 from the country of Honduras, driving across the border. And then the rest of all the ministers are going to be from El Salvador. So we're going to have a time. And you may ask, how many services are we going to have a day? We're going to have about 7 or 8 services a day. I mean, we're going to be preaching all day long, praying in the morning time, getting good fellowship together, and we're going to be preaching and teaching the Word of God all day. Come on, Brother Jeremy, preach to us. This is one of my good friends. We are so honored to have you preach to us tonight. We love Brother Jeremy and Caleb Prochazka.
Praise the Lord. Can I get a drummer up here? Spur of the moment. Amen. Is this a Pentecostal church or what? Okay, I'll just make it sure. Come on, worship the Lord with me. I just got this in my spirit tonight. Amen. I'm not an entertainer. You'll know that here in just a moment, but I do love to worship Jesus. Will you worship him with me tonight? I believe God wants to do something in this house.
Told the crowd with a voice of bold, he was clear and loud of repentance and water for their sin. But John said, there's one coming after me, he's mightier than I, just wait and see. He'll baptize you with the Holy Fire. Waiting for the promise then, 120 they were gathered in, just like Jesus said to them. When suddenly there came a sound like a rushing wind, it blew through them. They were all filled with the Holy Fire. So take me to the upper where the power came from an empty tomb, and across the blood came flowing down. And tarry here for a little while until you be endued with power from on high. It's a holy fire. They were waiting for the promise then. 120 they were gathered in, just like Jesus said to them. When suddenly there came a sound like a rushing wind, it blew through them. They were all filled with the Holy Fire. But that's not how the story ends. They came out of there like holy men. And nations heard a holy sound, and they turned the whole world upside down. It's a fire, it cannot be controlled. Take me to the upper room where the power came from an empty tomb, and a cross where the blood came flowing down. The power came from your children and their children too in need. Oh, it's a holy fire. Sing that with me. Take me to the upper room where the power came from an empty tomb and a cross where the blood came flowing. Sing this. Someone's about to get this. You can have this fire too. The wind of God can blow on you. It's a promise. It's given unto me. But it's not only just for you. It's for your children and their children too in need. Oh, it's a holy. Take me to the upper room where the power came from an empty tomb and a cross where the blood came flowing down. And tarry here for a little while until you be endued with power from on high. It's a holy fire.
Come on, lift your hands and thank the Lord right now. Hallelujah. Amen. How many believe we need that tonight? Amen. We need it right now. Amen. We don't need it tomorrow. We will need it tomorrow, but we need it before tomorrow. Amen. Thank you for being so kind. Worship the Lord with me tonight. It's a privilege to be here. Thank God for the opportunity. I'm excited about the time we're living, and I'm excited about what the Lord is doing. I'm glad to be a part of His end time move in this hour. Thankful to be a part of the greatest thing that the world has ever known anything about, the Church of the Living God. I don't know what can ever else give you greater purpose than that, to know you're a part of that, and I'm glad to be a part of it. And thankful that that opportunity to be a part of that has brought me here tonight to be with you all, because this is one of my favorite places to be. And if I knew that God didn't want me where I was, I might just pack up and move to Tyler, Texas. Amen. Because I just love this church. I love all of you, and I love your pastors. I thank God for him, Sister Tori, and their friendship, their kindness toward me through the years, and my family. They've loved us. Thank God for them, and I know that this church is a reflection of their anointing and leadership and the price, the cost, the obedience and everything. And I'm glad the Lord connected us and brought us together to do kingdom work together. And I'm thankful that for them tonight. And thank you for giving me the privilege to be here, Pastor Matt, and also to go to El Salvador. I'm so excited about doing that. Seeing the work that God's doing, I've been hearing through the testimonies through the last few years of everything the Lord is doing there, and thanking God for the fact that this testimony's going into all the earth and that this church is a part of that great commission. And I'm excited to go see the work and to be a part, a small part of this team this week and see God do wonderful things, I believe. I'm anticipating the Lord moving in a powerful way. And I sure want to do my part, so remember to pray for me and for us and for my family as well that will be tarrying by the stuff this week. They're getting a little bit of a break. We've had an extremely busy summer. Did 4 youth camps in a row, followed up by a youth camp conference. Thankfully, that 2 of those camps wasn't as far a distance. They were in Arkansas, but how many know camp is camping? Amen. So, you know, when you do 4 weeks of that in a row, and I'm getting older, but I'm thankful to be connected with what God's doing in these young people. I thought I was getting too old. I started pushing 40, and it seemed like opportunities to preach to young people started diminishing. But I crossed that threshold. Brother Kenny Morse was doing all the youth conferences around here. I got hope, crossed the threshold of 40 and had more opportunities to preach to young people than when I was young. I guess God ain't through. Come on. But I just know the Lord has connected me and whoever is a part of this generation, all of us in some capacity, because we're all a part of this end time move. And I want to tell you that God is going to do great things in our young people. I've watched that already this year especially. The Lord's not through. We like to write things off in the natural, but you know, God is not through. When it looks hopeless, the Lord can resurrect. Are you listening? Because that's the principle of everything we are. Resurrection is God's work. And that's something that he's doing. And I'm thankful to be connected with what I know God is doing something in this hour with our young people. God's preparing and raising them up to reach their generation. And so I'm glad to be connected with that. But I know that my family would love to be here. Kayla was trying to figure a way that she just said, you know, if there's places she would definitely want to come and not miss, it would be here. So she sends her greetings and her love, all of our family. Pray for them, but they do get a little bit of a rest this week. But we'll pick up again when we get back. Can you say amen? Amen. Well, if you have your Bibles, turn with me tonight to the book of Daniel. I want to read in Daniel one verse. I want to read in Matthew one verse. And really praying all day and just, you know, preparing for this moment. I'm not here just to fill a time slot. We are evangelists. That's just where God's called us for this time and has been for some time. But so we are always expecting the Lord to do something. I've been praying. I just kind of went through. I was back and forth between about three messages. And so I just want to ask Pastor Matt, can we schedule a revival for this fall? And if not, I've got to preach all three of them tonight. What do y'all want to come on? I'm just kidding. I'm not going to put him on the spot like that. But hey, that looked like a pretty good opportunity to make a pitch, wasn't it? There, we got the three messages, you know, I mean, we know how to squeeze things in. But I couldn't shake this. God just drop this. I just preached this message last Sunday morning at our home church, and the Lord just really gave it to me right before Sunday morning and just in preparation from Saturday to Sunday. You know, you're always praying, but it's got to be a preceding word. And I want to say there's some other things I feel I could better preach, but God wants to speak to someone tonight. I don't know what fragment of this message is going to talk to somebody, but it's going to change somebody in this place. And I know that by the Spirit. Now, I feel a little bit, I felt the Lord, you know, highlighting maybe it's something, you know, you can as preach the framework of something, do that a lot of times as an evangelist. You may have a framework, but there's always something the Holy Ghost highlights in that vessel. He knows what's there. So you never know. That's Pentecost preaching altogether. You never know what it's going to take you. It's a Spirit-led thing. But I do know that God is kind of unctioning me with something in the framework of this, but I want to preach to you under a thought tonight titled Building in Troublous Times. And I want you to stand with me for the reading of Daniel chapter 9, verse 25, if you have the ability to stand tonight. I'd like you to do that. And we're going to pray after the reading, and then we're just going to ask the Lord to add his blessing to this message here tonight. Now, my wife's not here, okay? So I got to have at least one section of guaranteed amens. She's always with me no matter where we go. So someone's going to have to step up tonight and give me some help. So Daniel chapter 9, one verse, verse number 25, says this. Now therefore and understand that from the going forth of the commandment to restore and to build Jerusalem unto the Messiah, the prince shall be 7 weeks and 62 weeks. The street shall be built again, and the wall even, everybody say even, in troublous times. Imagine that. One verse in Matthew chapter 16, verse number 18. The words of Jesus, you could quote this, I'm sure. And I say also unto thee,
that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. How many of you know Jesus is building his church? When he builds something, it's all the way to completion. I want to preach on building in troublous times tonight for just a few moments. Would you pray for me right now? Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be in this house. I thank you, Lord, for this ministry that's taken place already tonight, the nearness of your touch. I thank you, Lord, for this vessel. I thank you for this pastor, this church, and the testimony of Jesus that's in this house. I pray that you'd anoint me to convey the message tonight. You'd make my tongue the pen of a ready writer. Lord, that you'd open the hearts, Lord, of your people. Let the seed fall on good soil. God, I pray for the watering of the Holy Ghost. Confirm your word with signs following. Remove every distraction. Let nobody take this moment for granted. God, it'd be easy to just say, let's get on with this service tonight. We got things to do. But God, I pray let not one person take that attitude tonight and miss what you want to do in this house. We'll give you all the glory and all the praise because you alone are worthy of it. In Jesus' name, amen. And the church said, amen. Be seated in the presence of the Lord. I want to preach under building in troublous times. I don't believe that there should be anyone among us this evening that needs a convincing of the fact that we are in troublous times. While there have always been troublous times, I believe that we are perhaps in the most troublous that have ever been, at least in our lifetime. You see, time tonight would fail me to highlight all of the horrible conditions of our day, the moral depravity of our nation, the disintegration of all things decent, the extreme antagonism and pressure and opposition of enemy forces, sin abounding, truth falling, faith failing, church attendance declining, faithfulness becoming a lost attribute, saints stuck in religious ruts, and the church looking more like the world than Christ's holy bride. However, no matter how awful the conditions or hopeless the circumstances, I've got a word for you here tonight, and that word comes straight from the scripture and text that I gave to you and the latter part of Daniel's prophetic utterance, and that is this: it shall be built again, even in troublous times. Can you shout amen? As a matter of fact, troublous times are always more directly related to the building, and the troublousness of these times are more or less directly intended to hinder that building. You see, hell knows tonight that God is building something, and that is the reason for his opposition. I could take you through the scripture tonight and highlight time and again that when the people of God walked in unity with the Lord, in obedience to his will and the building of his testimony, how that the enemy always opposed such progress. How that he took from time, even in the past, he didn't mind there to be certain things that took place as long as there wasn't a full testimony. He doesn't matter to him a partial thing. He just doesn't want a full thing. David really didn't come under attack when he was anointed as king over Judah. He came under attack, drew out the enemy when he was anointed king over all Israel. You know what that tells me? That the enemy doesn't mind a partial Christ being preached and made known in this earth. He doesn't matter to him a partial Jesus. It doesn't matter to him a part-time thing, but But what matters to him is a full expression, a full anointing, a full demonstration, and a full Christ, both preached and lived in the lives of God's people. The enemy always comes out for a fight when it comes to the picking up and the building of the work of God. I could take you all the way back into the time of Ezra and show you how that whenever Israel came out of Babylonian captivity, how that those years that they had spent there in bondage and in oppression, but how that when that remnant came out, they came out for what? They came out for the work. They came out for the building. They came out for the testimony of the Lord. It wasn't all of them that came, but it was enough of them that came. Are you hearing me tonight? It didn't take everybody, but it did take a remnant, and God always works through that which is a piece of the original. Many had grown comfortable in Babylonian complacency. They got used to going to their stores. They got used to shopping in their malls. They got used to living in their houses, and they liked the comfortability of it. They didn't like anyone telling them what to do. They didn't like a fresh word coming from the pulpit and a flaming hot reality of the fact that they were living in a compromised place. They got comfortable, but there was some that knew that this ain't the way that it ought to be, and this ain't the way that we want to live. And so that company of people got up and they marched back down the streets into Jerusalem, and they said, "We're going to begin a work here." It was a small thing in its beginning. It was just a foundation that they laid there, but they were excited about the progress. That foundation was the temple. That foundation was the place where sacrifice would be made, where God would be worshiped in spirit and in truth. And they were set to begin there in that work. It wasn't long until the enemy come up, heard and witnessed and seen of the work going on, and he began to put his 2 cents in. The first strategy of his attack was he come to assist them in the building. You can read it there for yourself and find how that the enemy actually offered his assistance in the building of the temple. They said to him, "We worship your God. We worship the same God as you do. We worship this God. Let us help you in the labor of the building." But I'm glad to know that there were holy men of God who knew better than to take assistance from the enemy. He knew he just wanted his influence. He knew he just wanted his own input in the building, the work, the establishing, and the testimony and the running of the house of God. But thank God for men that knew better. Thank God for Zerubbabel and Joshua. Thank God for men that said, "Oh no, devil, I can see you from a mile away. You may say you worship our God, but we know better. We know you don't worship our God. You worship everything. It doesn't matter for you to say you worship our God." Friend, I want you to know something. They rose up and said, "You'll have no place here. We'll do this work ourselves." But I've watched through the years of time that same old tactic of the enemy. He's built churches all over America. He doesn't matter. He'll fill the building, brother. He'll assist you in the work. He'll fund the work. As long as he can have a side room somewhere. As long as he can advise you what to preach. As long as he can advise you what to go on in that house. How to run the system. How to run and function. But I want to tell you that he's come too late, brother, because there's still men that can say, "Devil, we can see what you're doing, and you have no place here. We'll build it ourselves, but you'll get no place here." But I tell you, he's offered his help, and a lot of people have given him help. That's why we have such the mixture that we have anymore. You see, the enemy's threat really wasn't necessarily the building of that place of worship so much as it was, although he was against that, because he knows that if that thing's begun, he knows God finishes what he does. Can you shout hallelujah if you believe that? And so what happened is he wanted to get that thing early on. And so he comes so subtly how he does. Oh, let me help you with that. But when he got snuffed out on that, he moved to something different. He drafted a letter, sent it across the river to the kings that ruled over there. Jerusalem was no threat to them. It was a broken down heap of rubbish. But I'll tell you, that enemy knew if they ever get excited about this, that's why God said to Zechariah, or through Zechariah, he said, don't despise the day of small things, because he knew that thing, even in its smallness, it may just be a seed today, but I know it'll be a stalk, and it'll be an ear, and it'll be budding with fruit before too long. That's why the enemy comes so subtly in that early day, and to get you in seed form. You see, these young people are so valuable and precious, but I tell you, there's an enemy that wants to rob them of what God wants to do before the thing ever gets going. He knows that if Caleb Gregory could ever see the plan that God has for him, if he could ever behold that, you know what he's going to do? He's going to say, my God, does he have a plan for my life? Does he have a purpose for me to fulfill? And so he'll come and try to rob that early on. But friend, you can't despise that small beginning. You need to hold that and value that and cultivate that and make that precious to you. That's why the enemy operates in that awful demonic thing of abortion, because he never wants that mama to see that ultrasound, and he sure doesn't want her to see that baby from the womb. It's the same thing Pharaoh did when he ordered the midwives to take the male on the stool, because he knew if mama ever sees that baby, she'll want to hold them eyes, them little fingers, them little toes. But you know what? He tries to do it before it's ever coming into fruition, because he knows if you see it, you'll want to walk in it. You'll want to hold it. You'll want to let that child grow. And I want you to know something, church. We need to rejoice over the smallness of our victories, no matter how big or little. I want you to know it's worth shouting about. No matter how big your testimony may seem, get excited about it, because it has to start somewhere. God is doing a work in your life. And then he moved on from that. He knew that they was not going to back down or allow their assistance. He sent the letter across the river. And he said, now, King, I'm paraphrasing a lot of stuff because we don't have the time to go to everything. But I just want you to know that when that letter got there, in paraphrasing, it said this. Now, you have heard about these Jews. You've heard about what they've done in the past, how they didn't pay their taxes, is what he was saying. They kept all the money. You got no money from them. And he's saying, King, if they build this, you're going to lose all your money on that side of the river. And I want you to know that the devil doesn't like to lose revenue. Can you shout amen? I said the devil doesn't like to lose revenue. And if he begins to lose revenue, he gets pretty aggravated about that. He knows if they get to worship in God, that's the starting place. They get that temple built and they're going to start worshiping again, and then everything else is going to come up around that. And so he tries early on in that threatening to discourage them, even though he did succeed. But I want you to know, at least in that initial thing, the enemy doesn't like to lose his taxes. And that's what the opposition is all about. He doesn't want a testimony in Tyler, Texas. He doesn't want you in your home and on your job, because if you ever start building up that testimony, he's going to lose his revenue. You say, Brother Jeremy, what are you saying? I'm saying the people that was spending their money on drugs is now building churches in El Salvador. People that were spending money on alcohol are now paying tithes to the kingdom of God. People that were involved in worldly affairs and building up their own kingdoms are supporting the work of God, and the enemy doesn't like that. I said he doesn't like that. Now, I want to look really at Nehemiah. I'm just giving you kind of the foundation of how the enemy opposes the building. Now, you know that he knows that Jesus was a carpenter, right? And the trouble really, really started getting heated about the time he said, tear this temple down and I'll build it in 3 days. Oh, I've heard that before. See, there was a prophecy that that branch would come and he would build. And don't think that enemy didn't know that. He always perks up in the building of something right and true and good. Now, Nehemiah, I want to look at him in a relation to this text and highlight to you this practical fulfillment of this prophetic word by Daniel. Now, you know the conditions of Nehemiah's day, don't you? His conditions were a poor testimony, a failure, debris, wreckage, and ruin. It says in Nehemiah 1 and 3, and they said to me, the remnant that are left of the captivity in the province are in great affliction and reproach, and the wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Notice that testimony of Nehemiah's day was a terrible thing, a failure and debris. Everywhere you looked, it was a representation of something that used to be. Notice that there was all of this going on. It didn't trouble nobody until it got back to Nehemiah. There really was no opposing forces, as long as, even though the temple had been established and the sacrifice and the worship of God was going on. But notice this, the enemy didn't really get too stirred up about things until Nehemiah said, we're not going to settle for this. We've got to build up the walls and the gates, because if we don't do that, then things can just come and go at will. They can allow anything in here to operate and move and to have its way inside that which was supposed to represent God only. And that's what stirred up the enemy. You say, Brother Jeremy, what are you saying? I'm saying that this testimony that once stood so wonderful and great had been broken down. There was a time that the kingdom was so expanded and the testimony of splendor was so wonderful that queens would come from thousands of miles to witness the glory and the splendor of God's testimony in the earth. But that had been broken down. But the trouble of it was, it really didn't bother a lot of people. Well, I can tell you what, you may sit there and be content to sit in the rubble and the ruin of a broken down testimony, but I know this evangelist can't sit by as long as there's breath in this body. What are you saying, preacher? I'm saying that testimony, those walls and those gates that represented God in the earth and testified to that ungodly world, it kept out the world, the flesh, and the devil, and those walls that separated, and those walls that divided, and those walls that protected everything that was right and holy and good had been torn down. And it didn't matter that they had church. If there wasn't nothing of distinction, it didn't matter that sacrifice was made. It didn't matter. Well, I'm telling you tonight, the devil don't care if you show up on Sunday night and you're just here to punch your little time clock and act like you just don't want the pastor to know you're backslid. It doesn't matter that you clocked in on Sunday morning or even Wednesday night. If there's no testifying of your life that there's something different about you other than the fact you go to a church building one time a week. It's a poor testimony. And I've witnessed this Pentecostal testimony be torn down, its gates burned with fire, and it seems to trouble nobody. We just go through our motions of religion. Our world goes to hell. Our kids get on drugs. I'm tired of seeing it. I'm tired of the pornography and the stories of people being bound. I'm tired of coddling this little flesh around, making excuses for people that don't want to be free, that people that fall to the traps of the devil, most of them aren't falling, most of them are jumping. They're sinning with their eyes wide open. They know what they're doing, and they're diving right into it. Don't tell me you didn't know better. You did know better. Are you hearing me? I'm not talking about people that just got in. I'm talking about people that shouldn't, that do know. They know more than most would know. But I'll tell you, there's a difference in falling into the enemy's schemes and you just diving right head on into it. But when there is no walls of separation and anything goes and anything's allowed and you do what you want to do, what's right in your own eyes, then it creates a conflict, brother. But I don't know about you, but I'm not settling for an American church culture that just puts up a church on every street corner. I'm just ready to see God's testimony be made known in this nation, not just in the world, but right here in America. But people need to know there has to be a distinction. There has to be something different. But if there is no wall, then anything's allowed. But when a wall is built, my friend, then only that is of the Lord Jesus is allowed in. That's what them gates represent. A ministry that says only Jesus is allowed here. Only Jesus can come through that gate. Jesus said a thief and a robber comes up another way. And if it's unwilling to come through the gate, then it's unwilling to be a part of this. I don't care how much money it has. I don't care how popular it is. You come through the gate or you don't come at all. Jesus said, I'm the door, I'm the gate. And I'll tell you what, if you don't come through that gate, you ain't a part of this reality, of this testimony of the church. Listen, we just think we can just allow whatever we want to allow. Well, we just, you know, it don't matter. I mean, we'll go into anything. It doesn't matter, just allow things into our life, allow things into our homes, all these kind of a thing. But I want you to know that all that leads to failure, wreckage, and to ruin. Broken down walls. And if that wall's not built, then I can assure you, then there's not a full testimony. Because things can come and go at will and call itself a Christian, call itself Pentecostal, call itself Spirit-filled, call itself what it wants. But I just call me old school if you want to call it that. I just call it right. And Jesus said, if any man comes to me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. He that saves his life will lose it, but he that loses his life for my sake will find it. And I want to tell you tonight, harvest time, from young to old, this price is still the same. Jesus ain't forcing nobody. He's just beckoning you. He's just calling you. But he's saying, if you're going to hear this call, you better take up your cross and follow me. That means you better pay it all, brother. You better know it's going to cost you everything. It's going to cost your life. But thank God, what you get in return will be far greater than anything you could ever imagine. Jesus said he'll give you his life. And I don't care if there's 15 or 1,500. We are not putting this gospel on wholesale. Jesus paid too much for us to reduce it. You give all or you get nothing. Brother Jeremy, how could you say he leaves the 99 to find the one? Thank God he does. But he also lets the rich young ruler walk. You know why? He was unwilling to give all. He wanted to keep a few commands and just add Jesus to his resume. That don't work with him. Jesus will sit there and watch you go away sorrowfully. That doesn't mean it won't break his heart, but that just means to let you know he ain't coming to change the requirements. He wants you to know, this, I paid too much for this. Have I bankrupted heaven if it could have been done? I tell you, he gave everything. He held nothing back. He gave his only son. He paid the ultimate price. He didn't just write, I love you, in the clouds. He come and wrapped himself in human flesh, took on the form of a servant, went and lived a life without blemish, and took that life to a cross, and that cross was crucified. Although he's the one that laid that life down, he's the one that picked it back up. But he said, I would spare nothing for you. I would pay all. I would give all. I would give everything. Jesus didn't just say how much he loved. He demonstrated how much he loved. And while we were yet sinners, Christ died for you. And you mean to tell me that we're just going to give part? You mean to tell me we're just going to be a Sunday morning saint or just a Sunday church goer and not give everything? Friend, we need to let people know in America again, you give everything. When you take up your cross, you pay the price. You don't add Jesus. You give your life to him totally. You know, it got them crowds followed him. His fame went throughout the earth. He didn't beg for no crowd. He had thousands of people, more than he can deal with. No Facebook in that day. That word was spreading throughout. Thousands of people. But when he got to preaching to them, many started walking away. He looked at his own 12, and you know what he said to them? You going too? Jesus will let you walk, brother. I said, he'll let you walk. We've made this thing too soft, my friend. I said, we've made it too soft. I'm telling you, you say, that's impossible. It is impossible. It's a narrow way, my friend. I said, it's a straight way. It's a straight gate. It's a narrow way. It's a broad way that leads to destruction. I want this herd mentality of this nation. People follow herds of crowds everywhere they go. I don't like herds. I don't like getting caught in them. And that whenever I see one going a certain way, I automatically stop and begin to evaluate what's happening. Because the Bible says the herd goes to destruction. I'm not looking for what the herd's doing. I'm looking for what God is saying. I'm looking for what Jesus is saying to me. I'm not looking for everybody's little opinion. I'm not looking for your little private interpretation of the scripture. I'm looking for what the Holy Ghost is revealing by the Spirit concerning the Lord Jesus, whether he says it right. I don't care who said it. I want to know what the scripture has said. I want to know what the Spirit has said. I want to know what God is speaking concerning the matter, friend, because if it's narrow, I don't want to get off track, and I'm not just going to base my criteria on this modern American church. I want to open up the Word of God and say, this is the way. Walk ye in it. I want to let people know it is narrow. It is straight. It is impossible to do apart from the Holy Ghost, but I'm also going to tell you that he that began a good work in you will be faithful to complete it into the day of Christ Jesus. He'll keep you. He'll keep you and present you spotless before his Father at his throne of glory, and he'll do it with exceeding joy. I want to tell you, God can keep you from falling, saints, if you'll stay with God. If you'll stay with him. But I tell you what, it's impossible for you to live and me to live, but it's not impossible for him to live. And if I'm born again, he lives in me. Do you know that? That when you're born again, in you is a seed that's incorruptible. It's created in righteousness and true holiness. It actually is incapable of sinning. It can't sin. That's why God gives no excuse for it. That's why we just coddle these little things around. Oh, they're struggling. Stop struggling. Stop. Somebody say stop. Oh, Pastor, I just can't quit. I just can't quit, Pastor. The devil is a liar.
Yes, he is. That's right, brother.
Don't give me this. You can't stop nothing. Amen. Just like I can stop eating chocolate cake. It's no different. It's no different. Say no, friend. Amen. Say no. I learned that having kids. I get anointed to say no. Amen. I'm telling you, when the anointing comes on me, I can say no to anything. And y'all seen my little girl. I'm telling you what, that thing's irresistible. That little girl, them little eyes, that curly hair, I mean, that's near irresistible, Sister Maddie. But I tell you what, I got to get anointed to tell her no. But I tell you what, the anointing will free you. You'll tell them no, brother. And you can tell the devil no. And you can tell the flesh no. And you know why you can? Because greater is he that is in you than he that's in the world. That which is born of the God, sin shall have no dominion over you. You can live free tonight. I said you can live free. Sin shall have no dominion when you're born of the Spirit. That man obeys God. Filled with the Holy Ghost, brother, nothing can stop you from the will of God. You know why? Because Jesus can live this through us. And if we'll let him do that, we'll stay right with him all the way. Amen. I don't have to live under man's opinions. I don't have to do, I can be led by him. I can be yoked up with him. He said, learn of me. I want you to know something. You can walk, you can live holy, righteously, and godly in this present evil world. If Noah can, how much more can we? He didn't have a Bible. He didn't have the Holy Ghost. And if that man can find grace, how much more can we? If that man can continue, how much more can we? I want to tell someone who the devil's lied to. You can be free tonight and you can live free. You say, Brother Jeremy, I'm weary with living in the debris and the wreckage of my failure and my ruin. Well, I want to tell you that tonight's the night you can begin to put things back together. I said, God can build things together. Put things together. Here is what the Lord just kept bringing. I had to look at this. Because it just kept coming up in my spirit. And this is what God wants to tell somebody specifically here tonight. You see, let me just take you there. This opposition to this building is here. Let me bring it down to it. You will notice that when you see the building of Nehemiah, when those walls begin to come up and those people begin to realize, hey, we're not going to live in debris and wreckage, failure and mixture the rest of our lives. God sent us back here to build a testimony. He didn't send us here to be controlled by the devil. He didn't send us here to settle for a partial victory. He sent us here to establish his testimony, to build up the walls and to let the world know that the church is here and we're here in the glory and the power of Jesus Christ. And I want you to know that the moment they begin to do that, the opposition to the building came. It was like something of a crescendo, an antagonism that was in proportion as the work went on. Nehemiah first came, and when he first got there to contemplate the proposition of building the walls, right off the bat, two men, Sanballat and Tobiah, here was grieved exceedingly. It says in verse 10 of chapter 2, they were grieved exceedingly when they heard about it. They said there was a man coming to seek the welfare of the children of Israel. I can promise you the enemy fears such steel, my friend. He doesn't matter these hirelings that are living for a paycheck and 3-4 vacations a year and some little cush job, letting anything go on. But the moment you get a man in this pulpit like I know you have here, that preaches the word of God uncompromised and says to you, we're going to build a testimony in Tyler and wherever God should open the door and let to seek the welfare of these broken down people in this earth, then the enemy knows it. And then it says that when they heard of that building, that indignation they took, and then it began to build because Nehemiah didn't let it bother him. It says that it came to pass as you go on through that chapter that when the people, because they had a mind to work, that said that the building went up to the half thereof. And when it went up halfway, you know what the enemy did? He got more angry. It says that he actually became very wroth. That meant he increased his intensity. And the more you continue building your testimony, and the more you continue in the work of God, the fiercer the enemy gets. It doesn't get easy, Brother Jackson. It doesn't get easy, Brother Gus. It gets hard, brother. Them attacks become more fierce. It's one thing when you started out. It's another thing when you continue. And about the half thereof, it said they grew very wroth every time that the inner counsels that were disclosed of what was happening there. You find that they had no enmity with Nehemiah nor the people. The only time they got enmity is when they found out they were going to keep building. As long as they were content to live in the debris of their failure, it didn't matter. Even if they had a church, but the second they said, I'm not content to live in this ruin, I want to see God's full testimony, I want to go all the way with the Lord, they got fiercer and fiercer. That's what began to happen. See, maybe you're here this morning and saying, Brother Jeremy, concerning all my troubles and perplexities, I don't know what this is all about. Well, this is what it's about. When you begin to build, the enemy becomes increases attacks more fiercely. You see, if they would have just been content to live and dwell in those ruins, it would have had no problem. But it was the building, the positive construction, the recovery of what represented the divine purpose of God, the object of a God-given prophecy. When they began to operate in that, when that was contemplated, there was opposition. Friend, I'm telling you, we need a full testimony of the Lord in this hour. Jesus in his fullness. Not a part Christ, a full Christ. That's why we need the baptism of the Holy Spirit and men that preach it. You say, Brother Jeremy, you're pretty radical. Well, I never found in this word of God where I could leave anything out. I never found a part Jesus isn't the fullness. I'm telling you, he never gave me no rights to preach part of him. You got to preach the whole counsel. You got to preach the full Christ. But when that work began, the enemy was in opposition for sure. As soon as they went on with that, they gave their hands to the work of Nehemiah. And here tonight, I'm among some people I believe that have given their hands to pursue the purposes of God. And those things now that we know were a shame for him, the poor testimony of that which claimed to represent him. And out of that, we are given to build up something that is for his glory. You hear me tonight? I said, we're given. I'm willing to give my hands to the work because I've got a promise tonight. You say, Brother Jeremy, why would you load them babies up and drive them across the country? I can tell you it's not for a paycheck, brother. It's because I got a promise tonight. And that promise is this. In the last days, saith God, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. And upon the handmaids and upon my servants in those days will I pour out my spirit. I've got a promise through Daniel that it shall be built again. That's why I can go into dead environments and churches that are twice dead and plucked up by the root when doubt and discouragement creeps in on a Monday morning and I just about rather go to the house. Something rises up on the inside of me and says, preacher, I said it shall be built again. That's why I'm preaching. That's why I'm preaching to these young people. That's why we're investing in this generation. It's because God's not done. He's going to build it again and he's going to build it even in troublous times. I wish revival could come when it was easy, when we prospered and all the bills were paid and everybody was healthy and all was well in the land. You had the president you wanted to have. Gas was about it, what you wanted it to be. Come on. I wish revival would come then. But this Bible tells me if it's real, it comes in troublous times. But it also tells me this, it shall be built again. We got people that want to quit. I feel the weariness in the body of Christ. I sense it, brother. The heaviness of discouragement among people. They think that there's no hope for nothing. That there's no hope for anything being different. There's no hope for their family. Their kids are in wreckage. Their marriage is in shambles. Their jobs are pitiful. All this going on, they're living in the debris. Many have failed them. That they've cost them themselves. Their own disobedience in the wreckage, the failure. You know what the Bible says? You can sense that, what I'm telling you. I can feel it, brother. And that's why the Holy Ghost began to light this fire in me last Saturday night into Sunday morning and began to say to me that he's going to build this church. I want to be God's mouthpiece to his people and say to those that are discouraged tonight, some of you, all you can see is wreckage and ruin. You see no way out. Some have become content to live in it. Some of you, you're not free. You ain't all the way free. You're here, but you're bound. You know you ain't worshiping totally. You know you ain't walking in the joy and the peace of the Lord on Monday morning. You don't want to quit. That's why you're here. You're not willing to give up. That's why you're still married. But I'm here to tell you, you can get comfortable and complacent in that mess. But God just brought me to harvest time tonight to tell somebody, it shall be built again. I said, it shall be built again, even in the troublous times. Stop waiting on things to get easy. Stop waiting on gas to go down. Stop waiting for a certain salary. Stop waiting till you graduate. Stop waiting till you get married. Stop waiting till you retire. Somebody needs to get up in this house and say, Lord, I'm tired of living in the wreckage of a failed testimony. I'm ready to do something about it. Here's what the Lord said, and this is what just kept going in my spirit on the way down here tonight, today. The threats of the enemy come, the opposition came like it did. And how does it come? Well, I could give you very quickly three things, at least, in just a few moments of time. And one is a weapon of ridicule. This is a tactic of the enemy. He said to them this, right off the bat, he was wroth, very wroth, and he said, verse number 2 of chapter 4, what do these feeble Jews, will they fortify themselves? Will they sacrifice? Will they make an end in a day? Will they revive the stones out of the heaps of rubbish which are burned? Man, that just kept, I didn't even highlight that. You know, the last Sunday morning, I didn't even highlight that part. But it just kept hitting me in my spirit on the way down here tonight. And I just believe that God, I said, that question, will they revive the stones out of the heaps of rubbish that are burned? How are they going to build this? And I began to think about those stones, what they represented. You know what those stones represented? Something that at one time had spiritual value. Something that one time was a part of a great work. Something that one time testified, Jesus is the Lord of my life. Jesus is the Lord of my family, my home, my testimony. It was something that sang about the goodness of God. It was something that testified of his wonderful name. Something that taught about his loving kindness. It was something that had value. Something that represented God in the earth. Something that was a part of something bigger than them. But that thing was broken down. However, whatever brought it down, it brought it down. and it brought down, and it testified what? It had failure written all over it. It was burned with fire. You know what brought their ruin in the beginning, friend. If God's people would have walked with him, it's impossible to be defeated. But they'd compromise. They rebelled. They mocked God. They served other gods. All this brought the failure that brought them to this place to begin with. Jerusalem was impenetrable, my friend. It was built in the munition of the rocks. They said the lame and the blind couldn't even go. There's no way. They said even they could go up in David's day. But you know, there was no way for anyone to penetrate Jerusalem. It was impossible, my friend. They had to siege the thing to get anything. They had to draw them out. It's impossible to tear it down. Not even the blind and the lame. Nothing could anything could bring that down. Whenever it was, or they could even guard it, rather, you could say, when that thing was at the testifying, walking right with God. But those stones represented the failures of yesterday. They had to face that. They had to walk in that, my friend. They had to overcome to the place. They had to see those stones break down. I want to tell somebody tonight, the enemy is tormenting your mind. I don't know who you are or how you failed or let God, your family, or yourself down. And the enemy is saying to you, are you going to revive these stones and build again with this? How is it even possible? You did have something of spiritual value. You used to testify the Lord, but it's not there no more. Just the failure of debris of yesterday's testimony. But I'm telling you, God has sent me tonight to tell somebody that we serve a God of the impossibilities, and he can build a wall with whatever he wants to build a wall with. And can he revive the stone? You better believe he can revive the stone, and he is going to revive it if you'll give yourself to the Lord. That which was of spiritual value can be brought together again. God can raise you up. He can set your testimony in the midst and be a separation again. You can testify of the Lord. And if you believe that, somebody shout amen. Amen. Musicians, as you come here tonight, I want to tell you, not only is this weapon of ridicule, ridicule is a simple thing, really. It's the weapon of a child. And this is how they began, in a very critical way. They stood around and they laughed at the people as they began to work. So much so that Nehemiah had to turn back to the Lord. Now, being mocked or ridiculed, you would think even if by the time you're an adult would be something that's easy to get over. But I'll tell you what, you may say, well, what does that matter? Have you ever been laughed at before? Have you ever been the center of someone else's mocking and ridicule and tearing down? I can assure you the devil knows how to choose his tools, friend. Don't miss what I'm calling these musicians, but I'm not done preaching. Amen. I'm closing. And as one man said, I think in this pulpit one time, you know what that means? Nothing. I heard that somewhere. I think it was here. Listen, I assure you that the devil knows how to choose his tools. He'll find people whose opinions really matter to us. There are certain people in our lives, realms of society and life, that the more that they mock us, the more they actually confirm that we're on the right track. But there are those that the enemy chooses, which he knows as he comes to us, criticisms from people and places that he knows will cause us to quit. He knows how to find the right source. He knows how to find the stuff that'll really bother you. But I can tell you that this one purpose he has behind it all, and that's to stop us to see the impossible fulfilled and to hinder the work of God, to accept despair. But I want to tell you, you can't quit tonight. God has a purpose for us to fulfill, and we can't let down in this hour. A weapon of ridicule. Then there's a weapon of confusion. You can go look at these yourself sometime. It was the goal of the enemy. Verse 8 and 9, it says, they conspired together to come and fight against Jerusalem and to hinder it. Nevertheless, we made our prayer to God, set a watch against them day and night because of them. See, it was their goal to take what was a very orderly process. You could preach any one of these points. Time would fail me, but I've tried to obey the Lord here tonight. And I'll tell you that this is a very orderly, every man had his hand set to the work. But how many of you know that it's the enemy's business to come in and get people out of their place, get them mixed up, to destroy the unity of the work? And that's why Nehemiah not only prayed about this, but he set a watch against it. This is a serious thing, brother. We're not just going to pray about this. We're going to watch over this. We're going to make sure that the enemy doesn't come in with these tactics. We're going to set a watch over. We're going to keep this thing, every man, his hand to the plow. Because when that first weapon of ridicule don't work, he moves on to this confusion. Gets people disputing and challenging and setting themselves against one another. Gets people suspicious of one another. But we must watch and pray, child of God. And lastly is a weapon of discouragement. And some of you may be here tonight. And discouragement is a very destructive force. Nothing's more powerful, I believe, in the life of a true child of God that wants to walk with the Lord. It's a destructive power of discouragement. The bearer of burdens began to weaken their hands and their strength was decaying. It was a different strategy. This wasn't an outward attack. It was an inward attack. It was something on the inside. It was a conscience insufficiency. It was a getting tired. It was no strength left. Praise has begun silenced. You're just discouraged. You see the helplessness, the hopelessness. You watch too much news. You have too many negative conversations. You evaluate your own conditions. You look at yourself too often. Your own weaknesses, failures, inabilities, and it zaps your strength. You can't worship. The applied pressure of that into our lives will leave us depleted and empty and unable to continue in the work. But I want to tell you this. Jesus is here tonight. Jesus is here. Whether you're being ridiculed, whether you're being confused, or whether you're being discouraged, I believe the Lord is here to tell you this. Church, it shall be built again. Even in troublous times, it's the church of the living God. Folks, we are the church. And we're going to go out of this place in the glory and power and the anointing of the Holy Ghost. He's coming for a bride without spot or wrinkle. Friend, it's time to put your hands to the work of Jesus. It's time to get back in the labor. This wall went up in 52 days, my friend. And I want to tell you as you stand here tonight that it doesn't matter what the situation of your life looks like, how broken down it may be, no matter whether all you have is a burned stone of something that lost its spiritual value somewhere along the trail, Jesus is here to put it back together. I believe the Lord is speaking in this house. I don't know what little piece of bread that this is giving someone tonight, but I'm trusting the Lord. God, to be very specific to your heart. If you just bow your heads with me tonight, let's just fix our eyes upon the Lord as we move down into this altar time. And let's just ask the Lord to search our hearts. God, I trust you tonight, Lord. I believe, God, I've done, Lord, to best to obey you tonight in this framework tonight, Lord. It's come out the way it's come out. And I believe you're speaking to hearts and lives tonight, God. And I pray, Lord, that you'd move across this house. Lord, let people know that are looking at the hopelessness of failed circumstances, that are discouraged by what they see in their families, in their jobs, in their nation, in the world, those that have, Lord, spent too much time fixated on how is it ever going to change? How are things ever going to get any better? How are we ever going to do the work of God? I want to tell you tonight, it shall be built again, even in troublous times. The word of the Lord is coming to your heart in this house tonight. You can reclaim whatever has been lost. You can build in the midst of the rubbish. Tonight's a night of victory, church. I said tonight's a night of victory. The enemy doesn't want the walls, but God does. Because I'll tell you what, the glory of this latter house shall be greater than the former. All around this house, let's find us a place. Get with the Lord. Come on, let's press in tonight. God wants to lift you up. Hallelujah.
You're the only thing that's left is sorrow and pain. into the place, watch dead things live again. One touch of His grace, and it's all washed away. He's calling out your name. It doesn't matter where you've been, whatever you have faced, don't be afraid to take Him to the place and watch dead things live again. One touch of His grace, and it's all washed away. He's calling out your name. It doesn't matter where you've been, whatever you have faced. Don't be afraid
to take Him to the place and watch dead things live again. One touch of His grace, and it's all. Calling out your name. It doesn't matter where you've been or whatever you have faced. But don't be afraid to take Him to the place where hope is given, where you're free from sin and shame, where He heals your broken heart. And He speaks new life again, where His love is ever drawing to a place where you'll never be alone. Alone. Take Him to the place and watch dead things live again. One touch of His grace, and it's all washed away. Calling out your name. It doesn't matter where you've been or whatever you have faced. Don't be afraid to take Him to the place and watch dead things live again. One touch of His grace, and it's all washed away. He's calling. It doesn't matter where you've been or whatever you have faced. Don't be afraid to take Him to the place where dreams were shattered and you felt you lost the race, where the only thing that's left is your sorrow and pain. Yes, you've wondered if you matter, or did anyone see you at all? At all. Take Him to the place and watch dead things live again. One touch of His grace, and it's all washed away. He's calling. It doesn't matter where you've been or whatever you have faced. Don't be afraid to take Him to the place. Oh, and let Him heal your heart, give you a new start. You'll find life brand new. Welcome.
I just believe we need to get in unity right now. If you're not praying, let's come in together right now in unity and agreement. I feel a pushing in my spirit right now. Somebody needs the help to get over into something right now. Come on, let's sing this song. Let's worship. I feel a wave of God's spirit. I don't believe the Lord's through in this house, but I feel something rumbling. The more I just kind of walk through this altar and pray, I feel a something right now. I'm telling you, I feel a wave of glory right now. Come on, we need to press into this moment. My God. Come on, on, saints. Come on, get in for the sake of somebody else. It may not be you. It may not be you, but somebody needs us to come together right now. In the name of the Lord, put your hands in His hands, saints. I said, put your hands in His hands. Let's build tonight. Shall this be built? We're the church. I'm telling you, the world's going to know. The world's going to know. Hallelujah.
For the
to stand and let's sing this together. You got to believe that God's going to give this church the victory, going to give you an individual victory, that there is no weapon formed against the church that can prosper. Let's sing it. Let's believe it. Do you believe that tonight? Come on, let's sing it like we really believe it. A victory.
For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Oh, I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Oh God, you take what the enemy meant for evil and you turn it for good. You turn it for good.
Oh, you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it for good. Satan, you take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. You turn it.
Tonight, he said, prayer warriors.
You turn it for